Hello guys, it's the 8th part of our full History of Pripyat miniseries. Last time we told you a bit about life in Pripyat, during its construction and after. This time we'll focus on the troubles that were haunting the power plant construction, and we will conclude with one of the reasons reactor number 4 in Chernobyl exploded. But let's not keep you waiting, here is the next part. Chapter 8. The on-hand experience. Initially, Bryukhanov was ordered to build a pair of RBMK nuclear reactors. A new model, which Russian acronym could be translated to high-power channel-type reactor. This new design was supposed to start the next stage of Russian technological power. Here it was, a physically larger and more powerful reactor than any other in the Rotten West. This wasn't only a matter of the design needs. Of course, a reactor capable of creating significantly higher power needed to be larger, especially the one which had to include a temporary or permanent lack of different materials due to their shortages in the Soviet Union. Yet, at the same time, it was a kind of tradition for both sides of the US-USSR conflict to compete with one another not only regarding the technology itself, but the size, value or cost. Or anything actually that could be better, bigger, stronger than the other party had. The new RBMK reactors could generate up to 1000 megawatts of electricity, which was enough to deliver it to at least a few million people, or, as they estimated it, at least 1 million homes, including apartments, houses or any other type. When Bryukhanov got the assignment from the minister from Moscow, he already knew that these plans were almost certainly too big to be fulfilled within the provided schedule. He knew that because of his own experience, but probably all different managers and directors knew it too. This was just the way it was around in the USSR. But when he actually started the construction, he faced problems he didn't even anticipate in his worst dreams. The deadlines set by the Ministry of Energy and Electrification were too ambitious. But nobody in Moscow cared about it. The minister and his associates had to show the party leadership their plans and tell them they will be fulfilled. No matter what the truth was. The plan was so underestimated, Viktor Bryukhanov quickly realized that he and his subordinates will have to work with superhuman speed. By the time Viktor got the assignment, the 9th five-year plan was created, and this new power plant was one of the most important goals set by that plan. It said that the first RBMK reactor should come online in December 1985, while the second one should follow and be activated 4 years later, at the end of 1979. Imagine yourself being dependent on a plan that was unrealistic. Your career, your family, even your own life could depend on whether and how you will fulfill this plan. Bryukhanov knew it. And he also knew the timetable was just impossible. As I told you in one of the previous episodes of this miniseries, because of the poor quality of materials and shortages, every construction like that had to include a stage called overhaul. Basically, this meant every single piece of equipment had to be dismantled to the last screw and bolt, checked for faults, and then assembled again. The same situation was with more important parts of the buildings. They even had to check if the concrete held together and search for cracks or any other signs of dangerous defects. Not only this stage raised the overall costs, but also created an additional to-do task in a plan, which made the timetable even more impossible to fulfill. Sometimes it meant a 50 or even 100% raise in costs and additional months of construction. But these weren't the only things Bryukhanov had to worry about. No wonder he struggled with disputes among his own construction managers and faced a lot of problems reported by the workers themselves. On top of that, he had to report to his Communist Party superiors in Kiev. He had to hire a lot of workers quickly, even before proper housing was available, and as the construction had priority, there were shortages of most of the other needed resources, like food. The lines in workers' canteens were often an hour long, which made it even more difficult to maintain the work progress at a stable speed. Sometimes you can expect people to work faster than usual for a short period of time, but not when they are hungry or malnourished. And Bryukhanov was held responsible for every problem there, both in Pripyat and at Chernobyl nuclear power plant. Of course, a regular worker couldn't just storm his office, but nonetheless, Viktor heard a lot of complaints from all directions and almost every manager he hired. There wasn't almost anything that both the construction and the people needed in reasonable amounts. Shopping felt more like hunting. One could never know what will he get, if anything. Sugar, salt, soap, toilet paper. These were the treasures that people always wanted. Not to mention anything more unusual, like canned meals, let alone fresh meat. I also recently explained to you why the USSR in the 70s and 80s had such economical troubles. But to sum it up, the centrally planned economy just didn't work, especially in a system that was based on nepotism, on being a yes-sir party member, and caring more about appearances than on real strength. The sight of crops rotting in the fields was nothing out of the ordinary, in different parts of the Soviet Union, which was an unimaginable thing in a country which had such a problem with empty shelves in grocery stores. I can imagine he was under a lot of stress. On the one hand, you have to deal with shortages of almost everything you need and everlasting dispute and dissatisfaction among your subordinates. On the other hand, you have to meet the time requirements that were impossible even before this whole construction started. Bryukhanov missed the deadlines, failed to provide necessary documents like design projects or cost estimates. He was regularly reprimanded. The pressure from the Communist Party was getting more intense with each passing day. He was long behind the monthly work quotas that were dictated by the party leadership in Moscow. Viktor Bryukhanov was a good speaker. He was educated and well-mannered. People just liked him and he could persuade them easily. He got a great memory, almost prodigious, and a good sense of economy and finances. He was also a person who understood many technical aspects of his assignment, which didn't happen very often in the USSR, which usually favored loyal people without any knowledge over specialists. This also made him very sure of himself and, at first, he declined the possibility of failing. This led him to the belief that he could always openly disagree with his superiors, because he was convinced that his arguments and point of view were understandable and reasonable. Unfortunately, he quickly realized that being right didn't mean that the Communist Party leaders will agree with him. He faced multiple reprimands and unpleasant meetings. The pressure of an unimaginably huge and important task was taking its toll on him. When he reached his limit, it was July 1972, and he traveled to Kyiv to meet his party-appointed supervisor. This person was a nominee from the ministry in Moscow, so Viktor gave him his letter of resignation. The supervisor read it and tore it in front of Bryukhanov. With very few words, he told him to forget about resigning and just get back to work. The director of the Chernobyl nuclear power plant understood that there was no turning back. But he realized one more thing. Being obedient to the party was more important than whatever else his job required. This was probably his breaking point, as having no escape made him both severely stressed and motivated. Failure could mean his life would end, not specifically as a metaphor. The next month, in August 1972, workers poured the first cubic meter of concrete to a hole, which would become the most important power plant in the Soviet Union in a matter of years. The timing was tough. Construction has just started and he had little more than 3 years to complete the first reactor building and to turn it online. It took 13 more years for the plan to be fulfilled, at least most of it. During another great October Revolution anniversary, on November the 7th, 1985, he stood side by side with important Communist Party members, seeing the newly constructed Pripyat Palace of Culture. He was acclaimed for fulfilling the party's plans and for being a strong leader of the city and the power plant. Despite having continuous troubles with the construction of both of those places, he managed to create a town out of nothing, which housed almost 50,000 people. A few kilometers away stood a huge nuclear power plant with four giant RBMK 1000 reactors. Soon, another two reactors would join. As the construction was going well, planned to be finished in about 2 years. So, in 1988, Bryukhanov would manage the largest nuclear power complex on Earth. That would make him a very powerful person, And maybe it would secure him a spot in Moscow, not as a manager, but as a party member of significant influence and achievements. The Chernobyl nuclear power plant, formerly known as Vladimir Ilyich Lenin Nuclear Power Station, was home to dozens of Soviet nuclear specialists from all around the country, including a lot of graduates from METHI, a Soviet counterpart of American MIT. However, his achievements were great, especially having in mind how many problems arose and were still present during the construction. There was something that Viktor Bryukhanov could not accomplish. Not him, nor anyone else. It was experience. Despite the USSR universities, especially METHI, being very good and educating their students well, the Soviets lacked the technology to train them enough. So, however the graduates had knowledge, they lacked on-hand experience. This meant that these engineers' work at the Chernobyl nuclear power plant would be their first practical use of the book knowledge they got during their studies. And that, among many other things, was probably one of the reasons behind the Chernobyl disaster. Thank you for watching this episode. It was the 8th part of our full History of Pripyat. If you would like to watch the previous ones, check our Chernobyl Stories playlist. I think that's enough for some time with one particular subject, so next week you will hear different stories about Chernobyl. We will, of course, continue this subject, but let's have a little break to cover other interesting facts, stories, and memories. That's it for today, guys. Take care, stay safe, and see you next week.